Good morning and welcome to the 32nd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning and Fulton McGregor is joining online. So our first item of business today is the continuation of evidence on the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. Today we're beginning phase two of our scrutiny of the bill and this will focus specifically on taking evidence on part four of the bill. And this covers the abolition of the not proven verdict and changes to jury sizes and majorities. We expect phase two to run to the end of this year, after which we will move on to considering the last two parts of the bill. So we're joined this morning by Professor Fiona Leverick, Professor of Criminal Law and Criminal Justice at the University of Glasgow School of Law, and Eamon Keane, Lecturer in Evidence and Criminal Procedure, also at the University of Glasgow School of Law. So welcome to you both. And I refer members to papers 1, 2, 3. And I intend to allow around 90 minutes for this session, but we might run on if required, as this is a key area of the bill. So if I may, I would like to begin with a general opening question, which I'd like to direct to Professor Leverick. So the Scottish jury research, which you were involved in, has helped inform the approach taken by the Scottish Government in part four of the bill. And before we move on to considering relevant findings of the research, I wonder if you could outline what you see as the strengths and possible limitations of the research methodology. So for example, in relation to the use of mock juries.
Okay, thank you, I can do that. To what extent can I assume that everybody knows what the methodology was, or should I run through that as well?
It might be helpful if you just do a quick, if there is such a thing as a quick run through.
I'll try. So as you probably know, the Scottish jury research was commissioned by the Scottish Government to try specifically to inform exactly the issues that we're talking about today. So the main purpose of it was to try and get a sense of what difference it might make to verdict choices under different conditions. So conditions where you had the not proven verdict, conditions where you only had two verdicts, conditions of different jury sizes, and conditions of different jury majority rules. And we also hoped to get a sense of kind of how jurors understood the not proven verdict and how they talked about it in deliberations. So briefly, as brief as I can, what we did. And I should also say it wasn't just me, it was a team, including people from Ipsos Mori and Vanessa Munro from Warwick and James Chalmers from Glasgow. We ran 64 mock juries and they all watched, they didn't all watch the same trial. We had two trials, we had a rape trial and an assault trial. And half of them watched the rape trial, half of them watched the assault trial. It was trial videos, but we tried to make them as realistic as we possibly could. They were scripted in conjunction with legal professionals. They were performed by actors, but the actors were coached by legal advocates to try and get their delivery kind of as accurate as it could be. The trial videos were just over an hour long. We had a real judge, Lord Bonamy, giving real legal directions at the end. So the jurors watched one of the trial videos and then they went away to deliberate to a verdict. And they had up to 90 minutes to deliberate. And we tried to make things as kind of as realistic as we possibly could. Now, obviously, there's limits to that. But the trials were filmed in a real courtroom. We tried to make it as kind of solemn as we possibly could. So we used kind of relatively kind of imposing buildings and the jurors all took the affirmation before they went away to deliberate. And what we did was in half of the juries had three verdicts available. Half of them only had two verdicts. Half of them were juries of 15. Half of them were juries of 12. Half of them had to strive for unanimity. So 15 or 12, or close to unanimity, so either 13 out of 15 or 10 out of 12. Half of them used a simple majority decision-making rule. And we basically took verdict choices from the jurors individually and from the juries collectively, And we also video recorded their deliberations so we could actually see how they talked about the not proven verdict. Jurors were made up to kind of reflect the sort of balance of the local population. They weren't, I mean, sometimes in experiments of this type, people use students because they're kind of convenient. But we actually had Ipsos Mori going out and recruiting people to reflect the makeup of the general population in terms of sex, age, education level, race, and so on. That's probably about it in terms of what we did. Now, in terms of the strengths and weaknesses of the methodology, I'll do the weaknesses first, because I mean, obviously, it's not real juries. Having said that, and they know it's not real as well. We didn't use deception. They know it's not a real trial. But I think having said that, against that point, what I would say is they all took it very seriously. I think they often forgot that the trial wasn't real. You would hear the jurors referring to things like, you know, people's motivations, people saying things like, oh, well, you know, she can't be that good an actress, talking about the level of emotion and actually forgetting this person was an actress. So they did take it seriously. They discussed the case seriously. But, you know, obviously, we couldn't make it real. And I think what I would say there also is there simply wouldn't have been a way to do this research with real juries. Because what we had to do here was we had to hold everything constant, so they all had to watch essentially the same trial, because we needed to see what difference it made varying the verdict conditions and the size conditions. You simply can't do that with real juries. You couldn't take a real trial and say, oh, we'll run it 64 times, but we'll do it with a different jury size and a different decision-making rule. It just couldn't be done. So in the sense of trying to see what difference the different kind of conditions made, there simply wasn't another way to do it. And I think it was made as realistic as it possibly could be. I don't think there's anything else we could have done to make it more realistic. Mm-hmm. People do sometimes criticise it in terms of saying, well, you know, they're not real jurors. We don't know whether real jurors would behave differently. And I think to that I would just say, yes, that's true. We don't know whether real jurors would behave differently. But I think the general thrust of what we found, which I can come to in a bit, probably does hold. I mean, we cannot say from our research that if you, say, took away the not proven verdict, we would get X more convictions. We simply can't say that. But what I think we can say is we know the direction of travel. So in other words, if we take away the not proven verdict, we know what direction things would go in terms of jurors being more or less likely to convict. But we can't put any numbers on it. It just, but I don't think there was no way of being able to do that anyway. So I don't know if that helps at all.
I think that is very helpful in setting the context and the reality of the sort of limitations that you faced in your research. Can I maybe just sort of tease out a little bit more around the strengths of the process that you engaged in running what was obviously a big piece of work?
Yeah. So was there a specific question around that, just the kind of the...
Just more around your observations of what you felt were the strengths of the mock jury trials that you arranged.
I think, well, obviously one of them is one that I have mentioned already, which is I think that they were the only way that you could do this sort of research. But I think the strengths of it really were that the trials that the jurors watched, although they were shorter than trials would normally be, you know, trials would not normally be an hour and they would normally be longer than that, but they did contain all the kind of essential features. They contained, you know, witnesses giving evidence, being cross-examined. The cross-examination was realistic. It was scripted by us, but with input from people who had actually acted in rape trials, assault trials. So the dialogue was realistic dialogue. the actors were professional actors who were coached on their performance by real advocates. And we did several takes in conjunction with the advocates who were advising us just to kind of make sure it was as realistic a delivery as possible. So those were definitely strengths. There were strengths in the sense that we just the environment in which we did the trials, we tried to make that as realistic as we possibly could as well. They were, you know, jurors, the jury sizes were realistic. Obviously, sometimes you see research of this type that might include deliberation, but they have tiny jury sizes. So the jury sizes were realistic. I mean, in short, we tried to make it as realistic as we possibly could. I think as well, I mean, there were two sort of sets of findings from the research. So one set of findings relates to what difference did it make to people's verdict choices when you varied the trial conditions. But the other findings were just how do jurors discuss, like, the not proven verdict and what it means in their deliberations. So a more, I suppose, what you call like a qualitative sort of aspect to it. And I see no reason why that would be any different in our research compared to reality, because they watched a trial that was as realistic as possible. They were given real directions from a real judge that exactly the same as real jurors would hear in a real trial. So I've really got... I don't really see how in a real trial that's going to differ very much. There's no kind of magic that suddenly happens, magic stardust that happens when you put jurors into a different room in a real trial and the way that they're going to discuss their understanding of the not proven verdict. So I think that aspect of the research is particularly strong, because I can't see really very many limitations with that at all. The way they talked about the verdict and their understanding of it is not going to be different to how real jurors would talk about it and understand it. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that was the sort of answer you were hoping for.
No, that's helpful, just to understand a little bit about the background detail, if you like, and just how robust the research was. So that's very helpful. I don't know, Eamon Keane, if you'd like to come in on anything at all.
I don't think there's terribly much I can add to that. I think that I would just emphasise the point that Professor Leverick has made, which is given what the research set out to understand, which is these unique features of the Scottish criminal jury, from a methodological perspective, that there was no other way to assess those features for the reasons that she has given.
Okay, thank you. And obviously, your joint submission that you sent in to committee supports the removal of the not proven verdict. So I wonder if you could just come back to yourself, Professor Leverick. So what does the Scottish jury research tell us about the use and impact of that particular verdict?
I think what it tells us, and this really comes from looking at the way that the jurors discuss the verdict in their deliberations, it tells us a few things. It tells us first that there was no kind of universal understanding amongst the jurors of what it meant. And actually that's not terribly surprising because, as I'm sure you know, it doesn't really have a clear definition that sets it apart from a verdict of not guilty in you know, directions that jurors will be given by the judge will basically say there are two verdicts of acquittal, not proven and not guilty, and they have exactly the same effect. So there isn't really a clear definition of not proven. And in the deliberations, it really did come across that jurors had rather different understandings of kind of what it might mean, that they were kind of projecting onto a verdict that actually doesn't really have a definition at all, apart from being the same as not guilty. So, for example, some jurors would say, well, this is the verdict that you should use if actually you think the person's guilty, but you're just not absolutely sure about that. Other jurors would say, well, we should use this verdict when we're just not sure at all. We're really not sure which way to go, so we'll just go for not proven. Some jurors, and this was more of a kind of collective thing, would use not proven as a kind of compromise verdict. Mm-hmm. So if the jury was finding it difficult to agree, say they were kind of split between conviction and acquittal, you know, in some of the juries you would have somebody would say, oh, well, why don't we just say not proven then? Because we can all agree on that. So they used it as a kind of a collective compromise verdict, mm-hmm. Which is a kind of slightly different meaning to attach to it. Some of them used it because they wanted to send a very distinct message through the verdict, but that message differed. It wasn't always the same. So some people used it because they said, well, I want to send a message to the accused person that actually mm-hmm. we think you're really guilty, mm-hmm. but we just don't think the evidence is there to mm-hmm. prove it. So sort of not guilty, but, you know, we know, really. Others used it to try and send a message, and this in particularly in the rape case that we had, to send a message to the complainer to say, look, you know, actually, we believe what you're saying, mm-hmm. but we just don't feel there's quite enough evidence there for conviction. So we feel we'll choose not proven because that's a kind of slightly more perhaps palatable verdict for you, the complainer, than a not guilty verdict. So I think what we found basically is there's a lot of different understandings of not proven. Unsurprisingly, they weren't all the same. And there were, I suppose as well, the other thing I would say is sometimes there were sometimes distinct misunderstandings. Not many, but you did have jurors who thought that there was a difference between the two verdicts, mm-hmm. despite the fact the judge had told them there wasn't. Mm-hmm. So some jurors thought that the difference was if you have a not guilty verdict, you can never be tried again. Mm-hmm. But if you have a not proven verdict, the door is always open to try you again if there's more evidence that comes to light. And that's a mistaken understanding, because that's not the case in law. So that came up, despite the fact that jurors were actually directed that wasn't the case. Not that often.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And I think I'm just going to bring in other members, because I know they'll be keen to probe a little bit about your findings. So I think Rona McKay, you'd like to start off.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Just on the points that you were talking about there, can you say at any point in a real courtroom, does the judge explain what not proven is, either in his summing up or in direction? That's the first part of my question, so I've another wee part to it. Because I genuinely don't know what is actually said in that respect.
Oh, sorry, should I briefly do that now? Well, do you want to do that? Or
I think I can offer some guidance on that. I mean, the jury manual, which is a document that is produced by the judiciary, which provides guidance to members of the judiciary as to how they are to approach charging a jury, mentions that it's dangerous to attempt to explain the differences between the two verdicts, because in law they mean exactly the same thing, given the progression of the law and where we've ended up with. I mean, I think perhaps a question for later on, but the manner in which the verdict has come to be used as a simple verdict of acquittal is not how it was originally introduced into Scots law, where we had a different system relating to general and special verdicts. But yeah, in essence, that what a judge would say in a trial, if they were following the guidance in the jury manual, is very, very little about the distinction between the two, other than they are verdicts, both verdicts of acquittal, and it's dangerous to attempt to explain the difference between them.
It's quite surprising to me that juries will not understand really what that is, and they're having to make that decision. You know, they're not fully understanding. So my next question was, do you think there should be more training given to juries? You know, I mean, do you think this manual's adequate? Or
I would just, can I come back on that quickly, Fiona? I mean, when we say juries aren't understanding, I mean, I wouldn't go that far. I mean, if we don't know that in essence, you know, definitively, because if they deliver a verdict of not proven in a case and they're told that not proven is a verdict of acquittal, well, you know, I think we can assume in some instances they are simply following the directions they are given, and they feel that the Crown has not proven their case beyond a reasonable doubt. It's a very difficult thing for any further guidance to be attempted to be delivered, because the law has developed in a way over recent years which just suggests That there is no distinction between these two things. And so I'm not sure what guidance we would seek to give them. I mean, I think they're told it is a verdict of acquittal, and if they deliver that verdict, then, you know, we can assume in some instances they are simply following the directions they've been given, applying their mind to the evidence that's been led in the case.
So in the mock trials, when you heard the discussing, you know, the deliberations, did you hear them sort of say, well, you know, I don't think there's enough evidence that, so we might as well say it's not proven, that kind of thing?
Yes, that, I mean, that yeah. would come up mm-hmm. quite a lot. Yeah, they would... I mean, so you would sometimes get people saying, well, I think it's not guilty because I think this person is definitely innocent. But somebody else will say, no, I'm not sure whether he's innocent or not, but I just don't feel there's enough evidence, so I'll go for not proven. But I think it's important to stress that's not a legal distinction. That's the meaning the jurors were putting onto it. And I don't blame them, to be honest, because it's a very difficult concept to really get your head around as a juror, that there are these two different verdicts, but they're both yet different, exactly the same. So I think anybody would try and think, oh, well, there must be some sort of difference between them.
Yeah.
So it's not really kind of the juror's fault that they started putting different meanings on them. But nonetheless, they are exactly the same in law. So it's very confusing for jurors, actually. Sure. It's not just confusing for jurors, it's confusing for everybody, I think. Involved in a trial, especially complainers, especially accused persons, because you can't really explain to somebody the difference between the two verdicts. If you get a not proven verdict at the end of a trial, it's very hard to say to somebody kind of what that means, other than just, oh, it's just the same as not guilty.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener. Thank you.
John Swinney.
Thank you, Convener. I think it might be helpful for the process of the committee's inquiry, if we could actually perhaps hear why we have not proven as a verdict.
I'm going to give that one to you.
So I think Mr. Keane, it's probably to you. You did kind of tiptoe into this this area. But I think just for completeness, I think we could do with how did we get here?
Yeah, that was silly of me in retrospect, but I will try my very best to provide what is, a brief summary. So in essence, the original verdicts in Scots law were guilty or not guilty, perhaps slightly different language used for them, given the type of English that was spoken in Scotland at the time. But anyway, we developed a system where we ended up with proven and not proven, because in the 16th and 17th centuries, there became a practice whereby the Crown in prosecuting cases would have a minor and major premise in an indictment. So the charge, the minor would list the facts of the case and the major would list what they say were the legal consequences of same. As a result of that practice, the defence bar then essentially started making quite lengthy submissions prior to probation, so prior to evidence being led, that even if the minor premise was found proven, the major did not follow what we would call in the law of evidence today, please, to the relevancy of indictments. It all became a bit of a power struggle, really, between the defence, the Crown and the judiciary in Scotland at that time. We are talking about hundreds of years ago, of course. This became ever more complicated, and a practice arose whereby the judiciary would issue lengthy interlocutory decisions prior to the jury trial beginning. So saying that if these facts are found proven, then we might, the minor premise is found proven and the major will essentially follow. It all became incredibly complicated, and during that period there was a shift towards juries reacting to these judgments that had been given prior to the leading of evidence, where they would deliver verdicts no longer in the kind of general sense, but in this kind of special sense of proven and not proven. And it would be for the judge then thereafter to interpret that verdict essentially and impose the consequences of same. This continued for some time. And there was eventually in the, I want to say 18th century, I think so.
1736?
Yeah, 1736. Essentially, the jury regained control of the system, so to speak, if you want to put it like that, because there was a famous case in which because of this interlocutory decision, very much curtailed what they could do. They wanted to deliver a verdict that would result in acquittal, and that was difficult given the decision of the court. And so there's a jury speech which has been lost in the mist of time. We don't have a record of what that says, but we have a verdict of the case, in essence, where they went back to delivering a verdict of not guilty, as opposed to one of proven or not proven, which had been in operation before. And then thereafter, there's a stretch of hundreds of years where these things are used in varying. There's a varying instance of all of various types of these verdicts throughout. Some of the great kind of figures of Scots law, like Hume, by the time he comes to write on the verdicts, offers a view on the distinction between these things. He calls it a matter of emphasis. Not guilty, I'm paraphrasing him, of course, but not guilty would be appropriate where there was clear innocence, whereas not proven might be appropriate where there is a lingering suspicion of such. But the jury nonetheless does not feel like the Crown has proven its case. In essence, this continues until the appeal court in the 20th century starts to issue judgments where they start to say that, well, we shouldn't be effectively explaining the distinction between these two things. It's dangerous because, I think, again, paraphrasing massively, the current dispensation we have is not the original purpose of the verdict. So not proven becomes a simple verdict of acquittal. This notion of interlocutory decisions pre-trial in respect of the special verdicts, so about the minor and major's premise, falls away in Scots law. And instead of the kind of system, I guess, kind of not proven going, it retains its status as a simple verdict of acquittal. That is a very hurried and probably somewhat muddled exploration of hundreds of years of Scottish legal history. Hopefully that's of some limited assistance. I mean, what I would say too, just in finishing that, is there have been over the years people who have you know, it's not a recent phenomenon to suggest that this dispensation is illogical. I mean, I think you can look back over the course of many, many years to find people saying that, and equally you can find people on the other side of the argument who think it's a valuable feature of Scots law.
Please.
Because I think it's what I would like to get on the record is you do sometimes have people saying not proven is the original Scottish verdict, and it has a kind of, you know, a very rich Scottish history to it, you know, and that's actually, it may well have a rich history, but it's not the original Scottish verdict. The original Scottish verdict system was not guilty and guilty. And I think it's quite important to kind of be aware of that, because it's not like, and also that not proven wasn't introduced to the system as a matter of design. It's not some great genius Scottish idea. It's historical accident. It's nothing more than that. So whatever the reasons may be for keeping it or getting rid of it, I think it being kind of some sort of original Scottish great idea is probably not one of them.
Thank you very much for that. And I in no way regret asking the question, because I think it is important that we have that understanding of the context and the emergence, because what I draw from that is that the historical development of the position we find ourselves in just now, would it be fair to say that that has fueled a lack of clarity in the potential decision-making of juries?
I'm not sure. Well, kind of. I mean, it's probably fueled a lack of clarity in the general understanding of not proven and what it means and not guilty, simply because it has had this history where it's kind of meant different things at different times. Whether the historical development now has led to jurors having a lack of clarity about it, I suppose yes, but perhaps only in the more recent history. I think the lack of clarity for jurors now is simply that they are told, as they should be, because it's the law, that there's no difference between the verdicts, and they find that very confusing.
But your research, Professor Leverick, would suggest, given your observations of the mock trials, that there are a multiplicity of different views as to what this verdict means, whether it's the Crown didn't prove its case sufficiently, or I want to send a signal to another.
Absolutely, yeah, but that comes about because there's a kind of definitional void that jurors can put their own meanings into, and they don't all come up with the same meaning.
Which, in a sense, is my point about the lack of clarity.
Yeah.
Because there is then, in the minds of the jury and their decision-making, they are not perhaps making the hardest of judgments between guilty and not guilty. You know, you've marshalled a number of scenarios where different perspectives may pertain as they make those decisions.
I mean, yes, I would agree with that.
Yeah. Now, if I could move on, Kavira, in relation to the research work that you undertook, I'd be interested to hear any differences in perspective or in substance of view that emerged in the sexual assault mock trial versus the non-sexual assault trial as to on this particular question.
Yeah. If we maybe start with probably the slightly easier part, which is kind of just how people understood and used not proven. I think there was a distinct difference in the sexual assault trial, because that was really the only trial where you saw jurors trying to use it to send a message to the complainer that she was believed. I think as well that was the trial, if I remember correctly, that was the trial where almost all of the cases came up where jurors used it as a compromise verdict because they couldn't agree. There might have been a couple of those in this, but it was definitely more common in the sexual assault trial that you would have jurors with very, very kind of polarised views about the case, and where they would use not proven just as a way to try and reach some sort of agreement. So in terms of just juror understandings and the way that jurors were using the not proven verdict, that was a little bit different between the two trials. It was also slightly different just in terms of the kind of the numbers game in terms of the verdict choices as well, because, and I'm going to refer to my notes because I always get this the wrong way round. So just in general, if you'll just excuse me doing the general position, then I'll talk about the two different trials. In general, so in the three verdict conditions, so if you had not proven, jurors were more likely to go for an acquittal verdict, or less likely to find the accused guilty. So that's the direction it pushed. Whereas if you had 15-person juries, they were more likely after deliberation to favour conviction. And in the simple majority condition, they were more likely after deliberation also to favour conviction. Now, if you took the sample as a whole, that was basically what we found. But those relationships or those findings were only statistically significant, and I can explain what that means if you want me to in a moment, were only statistically significant in the assault trial, except for the effect of the simple majority. The effect of simple majority verdicts was so strong, it held across both the trials. Simple majority verdicts push jurors after deliberation to favour conviction, and that held across both trials and was statistically significant. With the other changes, they were only statistically significant in the assault trial, which I appreciate that I actually have to read this stuff to actually make sure I get it right. It's quite a lot to get your head around. But the difference that the availability of the three verdicts made was only significant in the assault trial, I think, is maybe the one thing to get across. And I think that might be because there's other factors at play in sexual offence trials. So I don't know if that kind of helps at all.
Yeah, that is helpful. And it brings me on to the other area that I wanted to discuss, which is broadens the topic out slightly into the interaction which your research and your evidence paper helpfully draws out for the committee, between the relationship between the size of the jury, the question of majority versus supermajority, and the presence or non-presence, sorry, the presence or the absence of not proven. And I'm interested in the relationship between those three factors, because one might take the view that, that for all the arguments that Mr. Keane gave us a second ago, that, you know, not proven's really not helping us to have a clear criminal justice system. But the implications of that need to be carefully considered in relation to the impact on the other two questions about what is the optimum size of a jury and what is the argument, what are the arguments for simple majority versus supermajority. And I wonder if you could air some of the dynamics of that, the relationship within that triumvirate between jury size, majority versus supermajority, and presence of not proven.
Yes, I think the answer to that is, I mean, the one thing we can't do, and this is what I said right at the start, is kind of give a definitive answer as to, you know, if you change some parts of the system, exactly what effect that would have on verdicts in real trials. We can't do that.
Could I interrupt you a second, Professor Leverick? Because that's not what I'm asking you. I totally accept you can't do that. But I think what I'm interested in is what are the issues we have to consider to ensure fairness to and appropriate fairness to all parties. Because I stress fairness to all parties in who will be party to a trial.
So I'm going to say two things, and if you let me finish both of them, and then you can come back to me if you want. So the first thing I would say is that they push in different directions, these changes. So if you take away the not proven verdict, that pushes the system a little bit more towards, if I can use this phrase, to be a little bit more conviction-y. If you change the numbers on the jury from 15 to 12 after deliberation, that pushes the system a little bit more towards being a bit less conviction-y. And if you change the simple majority verdict and have, you know, a qualified majority or even a unanimity requirement, which I appreciate is not what's in the bill, then that will push you more towards a kind of acquittal. So you've got these factors pushing in different directions. We can't tell the magnitude of the changes, but those are the directions that they push in. So if you change one, you probably do have to think about the other two. And we did actually, and I've got it in front of me, we did do in the research, we looked at all kind of, because it was eight different possible combinations of variables that we looked at. So you could have, you know, 12 people, unanimity, three verdicts. You could have 15 people, simple majority, and two verdicts, for example. And we looked at the proportion of jurors that would have gone for guilty in each of those eight scenarios, and it varied from 3% to 37%, depending on the particular combinations of factors or design that you used. So they are all interlinked. So I think it would be a little bit dangerous to change one part of the system without also thinking about the other parts of the system, which I think is what you were getting at.
That's an incredibly helpful and illuminating answer. If I can just press further just on one specific and last point, Convener, is on the question of magnitude, just to make sure that I'm understanding correctly what you've said in that last answer, on particularly on the data point of 3% to the 37% point. Is that the scale of magnitude of difference that can prevail, given all the potential permutations that you've set out? So it is quite a wide variation.
Yes, But we have to remember that what we were doing was only looking at two very specific trials. I cannot sit here and say that would make that difference in reality.
But it wouldn't be wise for the committee to ignore the fact that there is the potential in the relationship between that triumvirate to create a set of circumstances that might lead to really quite large variance, which I would consider 3 to 37 to be really quite large variance.
Yes, but I would stress again, I can see where you're trying to take it, but I would stress again, I cannot say that is what would happen in reality.
Yeah.
These were two very specific trials that were designed for the purposes of research. They tell us the direction of change, but they cannot tell us the magnitude of it in reality. I'm really confident they show us the direction the changes go in. I'm not as confident about saying what the magnitude of those changes might be. But that was what we found for our particular two trials, the difference between 3% and 37%.
That's tremendously helpful information. Thank you.
Thank you. Pauline McNeill and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
It is complicated, I'll say that.
I find it complicated. I've been looking at this stuff for 7 years now.
So, apologies if my questions don't make sense, but I'll try and make sense of them. So, you said when your answer to the convener in relation to explaining these trials, these mock trials, about the way that these mock juries viewed not proven as against not guilty, and you said, the jury's saying, we just don't think the evidence is there, so they would select not proven. Is it fair to say that it's really important when we're looking at this to frame this in the context that the direction from the judge will be to the jury, as well as explaining what the difference is? But is it not fair to say the key thing is that where you have reasonable doubt... Mm-hmm. And is that not the key thing? Where the jury will be told, when there's reasonable doubt, you should not convict. Mm-hmm. If you work back from that, is it not fairly easy if you're a juror who thinks that they've got doubt in their mind about conviction, they just basically, it's going to be, either way, it's going to be a not guilty verdict. Is that fair to say that that's a context that's quite important?
I think so, yes. I wasn't saying necessarily that any of the... Some of the things that jurors did were misunderstandings, but that's not a misunderstanding. That's actually a completely legitimate way to reach a verdict. You're thinking, well, I've got reasonable doubt in my mind, I'm not sure, therefore I will go for an acquittal verdict. And whether it's not proven or not guilty is in some ways neither here nor there. So the jurors in that sense weren't behaving illegitimately. They were actually doing exactly what they're supposed to do.
Which is, yeah.
Which is, if they have, you know, if the case, they don't feel the case is proved beyond reasonable doubt, they should be delivering an acquittal verdict.
Yeah. Thank you.
But there were also other areas where I think their understandings were a bit more problematic. I mean, that particular understanding, I don't think is problematic at all. Mm-hmm. That's.
Yeah. I wanted to just examine the paragraph on page 6 in my papers, and this. The paragraph starts, in respect of the changes to the majority required for conviction, we see in the Criminal Law Review that article that the Scottish Jury Research found that jurors were more likely to favour conviction in a system of two verdicts than when the not proven verdict was available. So it's that paragraph I wanted to examine.
I might have to find out.
I'll just read that out.
Just read it out to me.
Yeah. So, given proposals elsewhere in the bill to abolish not proven and reduce the jury size without parallel reform to the jury majority requirement, this would have seen the government proposing a combination of variables identified as the most pro-conviction in the research. Yeah. Now, it's this paragraph next. The policy choice made by the government in the bill was a difficult one. And I think this is, I do think this is where the complexity lies for me anyway. Raising the majority required to see 10 out of 12 would run the risk that other reforms targeted at least in part at the low conviction rate in sexual offences may be thwarted. Now, Angela Constance has already, as Cabinet Secretary, has already said that the reforms are not targeted at specifically reducing the conviction rate.
I don't want to disagree with her. She's the only one who can say what the purpose of the reforms is.
Okay. Just when I read that, it reads it might have thwarted the government's, but the government may have started off there, but they're clear to us now that that's not the intention. But more importantly, you say, but the proposal for 8 out of 12 might be criticised for creating an unacceptable risk of wrongful conviction. And that's really what I want to ask you about.
Yeah.
Do you have some concerns then about that, the jury numbers? Yeah.
Do you want to?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's important context in this respect. I mean, you know, my understanding anyway, no other adversarial common law jurisdiction convicts on the basis of those numbers. That being said, 8 out of 12 is still a two-thirds requirement, but it's not one that's seen replicated in other adversarial common law jurisdictions. And I think that is important to acknowledge. I think, you know, I can only echo what is in the article, and that it is an extremely difficult policy choice. Yeah. Now, I accept what you have said about the purported aims not being in respect of increasing the conviction rate, but equally I understand why, if people were in favour of that, they might look at the majority as a central part of that problem, if you perceive it to be a problem. But it is it's a very difficult choice. You know, I don't know if you've got anything you want to add.
I think only that, I mean, this for me as well is the most difficult part of the decision that has to be made. And I can't sit here and say I have all the answers because I don't. I think one thing that's important to remember, though, is that any reforms, we were speaking about this earlier, any reforms that we make, they affect the whole system. They don't just affect sexual offence cases. I mean, it's not on the table to have a different verdict system or in relation to sexual offence cases. They affect the whole system. And so you would be having, on the current proposals, an 8-12 verdict would be enough, for example, to send somebody to prison for life if they were found guilty on 8 out of 12 for murder. I'm slightly uncomfortable about that. I don't have, because we didn't test an 8-12 system in the jury research, so, you know, I have nothing to offer from the jury research particularly about that use of the numbers. But I do feel slightly uncomfortable about 8-12, and it just feels a little bit too low for a decision that has such magnitude for the accused person. And I'm not, I think it's important to say that I'm not coming from any particular perspective here. I've done as much work on sexual offence cases and some of the issues that arise there as I have on preventing wrongful conviction. You know, I have no axe to grind here. I really don't. But I just, for me, 8-12 just feels a little bit low. And as Mr. Keane said, it's no other country that uses a jury system in the world, to my knowledge, would convict on 8-12. Some countries actually literally have unanimity. Canada, a lot of the American states. Others would go for 11 out of 12 or would go for 10 out of 12. I don't know anywhere else that uses 8-12.
I think if I just come very briefly on that, I mean, I agree with everything that's been said there, but I suppose important context too is that the Scots criminal jury is a very peculiar institution. I mean, no other system in the world convicts on the basis of a simple majority with 15 members. And a requirement for corroboration in the same way that we have too. So whilst I am definitely uncomfortable with the 8-10 figure, I'm equally uncomfortable with the simple majority as the law currently stands.
But we've got three verdicts and a simple majority. Is that not the important thing? So currently, there's the reason for a simple majority is because you've got three verdicts.
So that, I think that's a really astute observation. How this has tended to be justified in the past, the shortcomings or the perhaps problematic aspects of the various idiosyncratic features of the Scots criminal jury have been tended to be rationalised on the basis that it's a package. So there's a corroboration requirement. Oh, but there's also three verdicts. So that's okay to have a simple majority. I do not think that that is a particularly compelling argument, and I think that over the course of history it has led us not to introduce reforms that perhaps we should have introduced because we perceive this package to be...
I'm not disagreeing. No, I just get my head around that you're uncomfortable with a simple majority, but you do acknowledge that it's three verdicts and that's why it's a simple majority. Just finally, so England is at 10-12?
Yes, yeah. But I think what's important, actually, this is something I think that possibly is missing from the bill that you might want to consider. In England, it is 10 out of 12, but there is a rule that the jury has to try and reach unanimity. So they have to attempt all to agree. And only if they can't agree, I think it might be after 2 hours, can they then, if they wish, return a 10-12 verdict. And again, that's pretty universal in all other criminal justice systems that use juries that I know of, that they have a rule that the jury must at least attempt to reach a unanimous verdict. Thank and you. Only then, if they can't, can the
just
majority
rules
kick in. Just
a final question, just because you mentioned, Eamon, corroboration. So there's been a bit of discussion about the retention of corroboration. Would you have further concerns if we remove the requirement for corroboration under the current proposals in the bill, which would be the... qualified majority and two verdicts, would the removal of corroboration give you further concern?
I think so, yes. I mean, it's obviously a difficult question to answer in its kind of generality, but you know, these features are all interlinked. I didn't understand that to be a proposal that was on the table, but perhaps that's my misunderstanding, essentially.
Witnesses or people with an interest have said they've had discussions with the government about their view that corroboration, and there has been a recent decision or some commentary, I think, by the judiciary about corroboration. So who knows where we'll end up with this, but there's been talk. But thank you very much.
I think, John Sooney, you want to come in with a supplementary, and then I'll bring in.
Can I just follow up? Really, line of questioning from Polly McNeill about the impact of the recent Court of Appeal decision in relation to aspects of corroboration in sexual offence cases. Do you consider does that affect that balance that I'm interested in?
In one sense, everything affects the balance. It can be quite difficult. I mean, I think the Lord Advocate's reference to the judgment that you're referring to is transformative in certain respects as to how sexual offences are investigated and prosecuted. It inevitably will make the evidential requirement of sufficiency easier to obtain, and so. I think you can't. I can't sit here and say it's not an important judgment. I think it is a very, very important judgment. It does impinge upon this committee's consideration when it comes to further reform.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Russell Finlay, then Rona Mackay.
Thanks very much. Good morning.
Morning.
I find the insight into Not Proven fascinating and very helpful to our considerations. We've actually struggled as a committee to find legal practitioners who support abolition to give evidence to us. There's a very strong opposition to this. But I also get the sense from speaking to different people that the battle, they seem to accept that battle has perhaps been lost. Do you get any sense, can you give us any understanding of the sense of how significant the opposition remains, and even just what kind of continues to motivate this, given the direction of travel?
Yeah.
You can do that one.
I can perhaps give some sort of insight. I mean, I come to this as actually being a qualified and practicing solicitor too, albeit academia is now my first job. I have also, not that anyone would want to read it, but published a book chapter talking about the Scottish legal professions. Cultural attachment, I think, in some respects, to Not Proven. It was called The Nightmare of History, but which perhaps belies its message or gives away its message. I mean, I think that to answer your question, though, Mr. Findlay, I mean, why is it perceived to be such an important factor or matter? I think there's maybe two overarching reasons that I've identified, but of course, this is just my opinion. One of those, I think, goes back to what Mr. Swinney was saying about the kind of package and maybe the discussion that we've had about, you know, these features of the Scots jury, these three unique features rather of Scots criminal law and people, you know, practitioners thinking, well, I have worked in this system and I have seen this system work. That would be their view, I'd imagine, certainly. So that is certainly one factor. I think, too, I mean, we can't overlook the fact that, in my view anyway, some of this is what I perhaps would deem, well, what I call in the book chapter, kind of a notion of kind of Scots legal nationalism, if you will. So kind of cultural attachment to or a strong attachment to a feature of Scots law because it is unique and it is Scottish and people who work in this system have pride in the system. And I think that, you know, people may disagree with that, other groups may disagree with that, but the people who get up and do the job every day, you know, they value the system. And I think that goes some way to explaining the attachment to it. But I would qualify all of that by saying that sometimes there is commentary on Not Proven that is just historically inaccurate. And because there is this lacuna in terms of a definition, what does it mean? You know, it means the same thing as acquittal. I think I've seen lawyers fill that gap too, you know, in a way that the jury research shows that some mock jurors were doing and saying, well, it's actually the jury use it actually when they want to send a bit of a message and, you know, and that doesn't align with what the legal definition of it is now.
Yeah. Is A Nightmare of History still available?
Yes, all good bookshops.
I might as well get you a book plug for it, won't you?
Yeah. A little bit to that, because I agree with everything that you said. I think some of it is also just simply, you know, nobody likes change. I don't like change in my job. It's, you know, if I have to do my job slightly differently because things have changed, it's not a very pleasant thing. But I think there are arguments, or at least one decent argument for Not Proven, which is that it possibly does have a slight protective effect against wrongful conviction. It's not like there's no possible arguments for the verdict.
Yeah.
However, I think that argument, if it holds, is outweighed by a lot of the arguments against it. So people who are attached to Not Proven are not necessarily irrational, because there is that argument that can be made for it. It possibly does have a slight protective effect against wrongful conviction. So, but it's just, I think the other arguments against it are much stronger.
Now, I spent some time reading the 2014 Academic Expert Group report.
Oh, good grief.
Yeah. It's lengthy.
That's huge.
Yeah. Now, there's quite a significant chapter on jury sizes and the issue of majority v unanimity. And if you take the, and this is a brief summary, but if you take England, Wales, Ireland, Australia, New Zealand, US, Canada, 12 is typical.
Yeah.
And the chapter describes Scotland as being very peculiar indeed with 15 and the other issues we've touched upon. And in those jurisdictions, almost all, it's either 10 or 11 of 12, with various other considerations sometimes coming into play, such as the seriousness of the offence.
Yeah.
Or the length of time that has been spent considering not being able to reach unanimity. Now, the Faculty of Advocates have said in response to the bill that what's being proposed in Scotland would be to reduce the 15 to 12 and for the verdict to be reached on a basis of 8 of 12. And their exact quote to us is, the inevitable consequence of Scotland adopting a majority of 8 from 12 would be an international communication that Scotland places less value in protecting its citizens accused of crime than any and every other nation with a jury system, which is a very strong thing to say. And a note in your submission to us, and you've touched on this verbally as well, you welcome the 8 of 12, but not unconditionally. You say somewhat tentatively, and you also say that a judgment call needs to be made. So now you're here today. What is your judgment? What would be the ideal number?
I don't think I can give you an answer. I know you want an answer to that, but I don't think...
Even just a sense, I mean, because you're not comfortable with 8 of 12, clearly.
If I had to pick a number, I would probably run with a system that's been tried and tested in other nations, not necessarily just England and Wales, because I realise that has sensitivities, but I would probably want to see that the jury strives initially for unanimity, but if they can't get there... that maybe 10 out of 12 would do. But that's, you know, I wouldn't say that's a particularly firm view.
Sure.
But I,
well, that's
I,
helpful. Yeah, and do you have a view on that as well?
Yeah, I think if pushed, and I am being pushed, that is where I would end up in terms of my thinking at the moment. But I equally do see arguments that come from other organisations which talk about, well, if the purpose, and I know we've been told that's not the purpose, but if we're concerned about complainers and sexual offences cases, then that particular threshold might have an impact. But my own personal view is aligned with Professor Leverick's. I think that if you strive for unanimity but you can't get there, you get 10, then that seems to me to be a reasonable place to end up.
Some jurisdictions, it's 2 hours, it's 6 hours. It's, would you have any sense of what that might be?
Yeah.
Do you have a view as to what Scotland might want to adopt if that was to be...
I really don't have a view on that. I think my view would be it's important that for me, I think the jury should try and reach unanimity because although we haven't really had that kind of cultural sense of doing that in Scotland because we've always had majority verdicts, but I think if you value juries and you value deliberation, I think there is something to be said for trying to get the jury to all agree. Because then I think that's the best way of actually bringing out, you know, the various different arguments, perspectives, various different views on the evidence to make sure the case, to really kind of give the public the confidence the case has been discussed properly. As to how long you ask them to do that, I really couldn't say.
What about the issue of perhaps the seriousness of the crime requiring unanimity? In certain cases,
I think that's just. I wouldn't have a system that complex
too
where you
complex.
Have different requirements for different. Right. I mean, where would you draw the line?
So.
What would you do if you had two different charges on the indictment that were? I just think that's
good point.
Too complicated.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Now, see, in terms of your research, there'll be people in the legal profession who will want to question the methodology because they don't agree with a lot of what's being proposed. Yeah. Where did you find your mock jurors? How were they found?
They were recruited by Ipsos Mori through a mixture of on-street recruiting. I have a previous life where I used to actually work as a market researcher, so I have some insight into this. So a mixture of on-street recruiting where you literally kind of go to a public place and you approach people and say, would you like to take part in a piece of research? Yeah. They did some door-to-door recruiting as well. So it was just kind of going out basically into places where you would find the general public and saying, we're doing this research project.
Were the people paid?
Yes, they were paid, yes.
And so they were all willing participants, because, I mean, one thing that perhaps differs from real jurors is the sense I get anecdotally is most of them are rather reluctant. But I guess there's nothing you can do about that.
I'm not really sure that makes any of that makes much difference to the findings, to be honest. I mean, they were paid because we were asking them to give up 4 or 5 hours of their time. I think we had to pay people. It wouldn't be fair if we didn't do otherwise. Yeah. Very few people who were approached by Ipsos Mori actually refused. I don't have figures on that, but just from the sense of when we were doing it at the time, very few people who were asked to take part actually refused to take part. So in that sense, that some people have said our research is different because, well, it's all volunteers. And so you're getting a completely different sort of segment of the public than you would get in real juries because they're compelled. I don't think there's much in that argument, to be honest, because, A, most of our jurors or people who were approached on the streets did agree to take part. But, B, everybody that we had on our mock jurors was eligible for jury service. You know, that they could easily be real jurors in a real case.
Have either of you been jurors in the past?
No. I'm not allowed to be because I'm a qualified lawyer.
Right. I actually could be because I didn't go all the way through to qualifying as a lawyer. But the one time I would love to be on a jury, but the one time I was actually asked to do it, it was literally about 2 weeks after I'd had my daughter, so I just couldn't get there. And they've never asked me since. So,
oh well,
they'd probably reject me if I was there, to be honest.
I think there's every chance. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, my question was going to be exactly the same as Russell Finlay's into trying to push you in to say what your preferred balance would be. But I just want to get on record, going back to sexual offence cases that the not proven verdicts used disproportionately in rape cases. Not proven made up 44% of rape and attempted rape acquittals, compared with 20% for all crimes and offences. So that's a, you know, a huge balance.
Yeah.
So your research has led you to believe that we should abolish the not proven verdict. And you've answered the question about you can't really say what your preferred balance would be. Can I ask you, again, this is a tricky one. In your estimation, what do you think the legal profession, given that this would happen, would be acceptable to them? What do you think they might suggest as being an optimum?
I think you'll have to ask the legal profession representatives.
With your background, maybe you would sort of...
I really wouldn't want to speak on behalf of every solicitor or an advocate in Scotland.
I understand. That's fine. I just wondered if there was a kind of an easy path that you think, well, that might be acceptable if you went along those lines. But I appreciate what you're saying. Yeah, I need to ask them.
Sorry.
That's fine. Convener, thank you.
Thank you. I wondered if I can just come in, and it's picking up a little bit on a point that you made earlier about the sort of potential for not proven to almost be used as a compromised verdict. And that links to the issue of public confidence. Yeah. And in your submission, in terms of the arguments sort of set out against the retention of not proven verdict, you say the first argument is around stigma, which we can maybe come to, but the second argument is that it risks a loss of public confidence in the criminal justice system, as it allows jurors to use it as a compromise verdict, bring deliberations to an end rather than engaging in more rigorous discussions. There is empirical evidence from the Scottish jury research that the verdict operates in precisely this way, with the participants using it to bring deliberations to a premature end. So I'm interested in how important is public confidence in our sort of deliberations, and what your observations may be in and around that, particularly from the research that you've done.
Yeah, I've obviously thought about this topic a lot over a long period of time. I've actually come around to thinking this is probably the strongest argument for getting rid of the not proven verdict, because it was... Now, OK, we have to put all the qualifications in place that it wasn't real trials, it wasn't real juries. However, jurors were distinctly using it in our research as a way to actually say, well, this is all getting too difficult, you know, let's just compromise. Now, we don't know if that happens in real trials. Maybe it doesn't. But I think if there's even the slightest risk that that might be happening in real trials, that's actually a very strong argument against the verdict, because another strand of research I personally wasn't involved with, but one of my colleagues, Professor Vanessa Munro, was involved with, she spoke to complainers in sexual offence cases whose case had ended in a not proven verdict. And one of the things that was coming out very strongly from that is the people that she spoke to felt that the not proven verdict it gave juries too easy a way out, that they really wanted to know that their case and the evidence had been discussed as fully and as properly, as diligently as it possibly could. And they felt that getting a not proven verdict might have meant that the jury just didn't go there. They avoided kind of other more difficult deliberation that they might have had to have if you only had a not guilty and a not proven verdict. And I think it's really important that the public, complainers, everybody has confidence that juries... I mean, this is such a crucial decision that juries are making that has such a massive impact on lots of people's lives. And I just think the public confidence argument is a really strong one. We should be making sure that juries treat that with the seriousness and the diligence that it deserves. And I think that having the not proven verdict, there is a risk that they maybe don't do that, if that makes any sense.
Thank you. Eamon Keane, do you want to add anything?
Yeah. I just think I'd probably echo all of that and say that actually, or emphasise rather, that public public confidence in the criminal justice system is absolutely key. Mm-hmm. And that crosses both sides of the bar, so to speak, in the sense that we need to have witnesses who come to court with a view that they will be treated fairly and that the system is logical and coherent. And equally, we need to have individuals who are accused of crime who will believe or do believe that the system will treat them fairly and protect their rights. So I think public confidence is at the absolute core of what the committee is considering with this bill. I mean, my own personal view is, you know, I can say before it was before it was perhaps trendy to say so in certain circles, before the jury research was published, I'd long been of the view that the not proven verdict in its current dispensation was illogical and irrational, and that if people were going to design a system, they would not design the one that we have, and that surely the law above all else should be about logic and clarity and, you know, those particular factors. And not proven, in my view, with the situation we have now, does not give us that. So I mm-hmm. to go back to your other question, I think it's key. And I think that, you know, that perception that's been spoke about from Professor Munro's work, from people who have actually given evidence in these cases, you know, the notion that, you know, that it's some sort of halfway house mm-hmm. pertains with them, and that is damaging.
Yeah, thank you. And just suppose, just to pick up on you, the point that you made, Professor Leverick, about sort of sexual offences, and in your submission, you've set out that there was also evidence that this use of not proven. Yeah. Was read into the verdict outcome by sexual offences complainers, undermining their belief that jurors discharged the weighty responsibility placed upon them with appropriate diligence. So that's quite a powerful commentary. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else?
Yeah, that's not, you know, my words. That's the words that was coming from the people that Professor Munro mm-hmm. spoke to. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's difficult because it's hard to say that if the complainers that she spoke to, if they'd received, say, at the end of their case, a not guilty verdict, I'm not sure they would have felt a lot better, because obviously if you're going in as a complainer, what you actually want is a conviction. But I think this did come across very strongly, that the not proven verdict people felt was particularly difficult for them to take, because, as you say, they felt there was a risk that the jury just hadn't discharged its function properly, and if you didn't have that verdict, they would have been forced to engage in further difficult deliberation that might have resulted in a guilty verdict. It might not, but at least they would have known that the case had been discussed as fully as it possibly could be.
Thank you. Okay, I'm going to bring John Swinney back in, then Sharon Dowie.
Thanks, Convener. I wonder if our panellists made a comment about the unanimity provision in certain other jurisdictions. And I'm interested just to understand why we have a majority tradition and not a unanimity tradition.
Do you know the answer to that?
Probably don't have I can certainly perhaps do a bit more research and find out. What I know, Mr. Swinney, is that, you know, I think collectively, or we've not, culturally rather, the jury has not been viewed, because of it, the way it's developed in Scotland, it doesn't have the same kind of, how shall I put it, the notion of a collective decision has always been something that doesn't have the same strength here than perhaps it has in, for example, America and Canada, where that is an absolute requirement. I don't want to start guessing, and I can go in and look into this and provide you with some information, but I suspect that because we ended up with the jury the size that we did, 15 members, and the way of delivering a verdict, that yes, that there. It developed organically over that period. There is one kind of definitive. It's actually a PhD thesis on the history of the Scots jury, and I can certainly go away and provide information in that respect.
I think that's in a sense that answer is very helpful, because I think it adds to the committee's consideration of what we must think about in relation to. Go back to my earlier questions, the relationship between jury size, majority versus supermajority, and potential abolition of not proven? Because I think that answer and the lack of absolute certainty about why we are where we are is part of establishing what's the proper relationship between these three factors. Because I can see, you know, for example, we went to a unanimity position. Mm. That strikes me as being a really significant move in Scottish jury approaches and requiring a very significant raising of the bar for potential conviction, which, you know, must of course be substantiated, but there also must be, you know, there must be, to go back to your point earlier on, Mr. Keane, there must be public confidence,
yes,
in the criminal justice system, and we have to be careful that we don't put the bar too high up.
Oh, absolutely. I think I would agree with that in its entirety. I mean, yes, we can get guidance from other similar legal systems and jurisdictions, but equally those jurisdictions do things in a very different way than we do them in Scotland. Yeah, yeah. You know, for example, we don't allow juries to hang in criminal trials in Scotland. You know, nobody has really touched upon that thus far, but that is an important consideration when we talk about our cultural approach and historical approach in Scotland. So, yeah, I mean, without speaking unnecessarily on that topic, I would agree entirely. Public confidence has to remain key, and we need to be sure of the relationship between all these things and Scotland's cultural and legal historical heritage when it comes to trial by jury.
Thank you.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. It certainly is confusing. I'm just thinking, so we've got majority, supermajority, simple majority, unanimity. So on what you've said, I think you're in favour of unanimity. No. But going for 10 out of 12.
Trying to reach a unanimous decision, because that just encourages a good discussion. But I think actually having an absolute unanimity requirement, I don't think personally I would go for that.
So it's striving for unanimity, yeah, but 10 out of 12. But
10 out of... Yes, although with... You really pushed me on the 10 out of 12 thing. I'm not, you know, I'm really not sure about that. But yeah.
Right. Okay. Oh. Just a wee quick question then. I was actually, the convener had asked the one about the compromise verdict for not proven, but you've answered that. So just the one on the changing the majorities to two-thirds. The Crown Office suggested introducing a system for retrials. Mm. Should the two-third majority just be missed? So it's like 7 jurors out of 12. So do you think that's something the bill should have incorporated in it?
Possibly. I mean... I'm not sure. This is a slightly dodging the question, but I'm not sure it would make that much difference, because I think what we would probably find is if we introduced 8 out of 12, almost all juries would get there. I mean, the evidence is from other countries that have qualified majorities or even unanimity requirements is that the jury almost always does eventually reach them. And actually, hung trials are very, very rare. So I'm not sure I have a firm view on whether we should allow for the possibility of retrial after a hung jury, but I think whether we do or we don't, it's probably not going to make an awful lot of difference. I don't know if we haven't discussed this. I don't know if you agree with me or not.
Yeah. I think so. I mean, we've never allowed... I mean, juries have to reach a verdict in Scotland. Again, talking about that kind of cultural context and historical context, we've never had a system in the criminal justice sphere where we allow juries to simply not agree. They need to reach a verdict. A verdict needs to be delivered. So it would be a significant change to introduce a mechanism by which retrial could be sought and authorised if there was an inability to reach a decision. Though I suspect that's not quite what your question was. It was about the Crown's proposal that they should be allowed to seek a retrial. Tentatively, I suppose, I think that could be could be useful, but I would need much more detail. I mean, what are the what's the court's criteria for granting that? You know, is it simply the split in numbers? Are there other factors?
Yeah, it would have to be some sort of public interest test, I think. So, because obviously, you know, staging, having a retrial costs money and time, and you're bringing all the people together again. And
I think that in England, it might even be as low as 1%. Yeah. I think of criminal trials result in a hung jury in a retrial.
It's even less. It's lower than 1%. Because in England, you know, with a hung jury, where they don't reach the majority, you can apply for a retrial, but it's lower than 1% of cases where that actually happens. When jurors are when jurors are pushed towards trying to reach, you know, a certain qualified majority or unanimity, they generally do that. Even in Canada, where they have an absolute unanimity requirement, I was looking at this the other day, it's only 1% of cases where jurors actually fail to get there. Which I admit, if 1% of 100,000 cases is perhaps a significant number of potential retrials, but it's a very small minority of cases where the jury doesn't eventually reach whatever the requirement is.
Something that maybe needs a bit more conversation. I'm just looking at the comments pushed towards, and almost always get a verdict, but that still means 4 out of the 12 are saying that the person's innocent if you're going for a conviction of guilty. So, okay, thank you.
Thank you. So then,
just on the point of juries being unable to reach a verdict, the most recent research, I think, is from New Zealand and from 2000, which shows the hung jury rate of 8.7%, which is quite significant. And I just wonder whether, if the bill doesn't include it, the ability to, you know, have a retrial, whether there should be some kind of robust post-legislative scrutiny of the impact that would then require the government to revisit that particular issue.
I think what I would say about that particular piece of research, though, is that it's possibly slightly misleading, because they included in, was it 8.7%, did you say?
Yeah.
They included in that any case where, say, there was multiple charges, and were in any one of the charges they failed to reach a verdict. Say that, you know, they might have reached a verdict on the three most serious ones, but not in terms of perhaps a minor offence or something. So I think the 8.7% is, okay, it's probably a little bit higher than a slightly misleading figure.
Yeah. So, I mean, we don't know, but we might expect the numbers here to be similar to what we see elsewhere, and that's maybe a bit more unusual. But notwithstanding what the number might be, should there be that safeguard potentially of a post-legislative scrutiny?
I mean, possibly. It's certainly something that would be worth looking at. But we kind of have to work out what we're doing first, and then,
of course, and then
I think with any of these changes, I think post-legislative scrutiny would be a good idea.
And then, of course, decipher what might be considered to be normal and regular, and what might be considered to be concerning.
Yeah, I mean, that's the difficulty with all of this is that there's very few cases where you can actually say for sure what the correct verdict ought to be. And what the correct outcome ought to be. It's, you know, only... So it's whatever kind of changes in the balance of verdicts happens after we put the proposals into place, it's quite difficult to evaluate that, because we don't... You need some sort of objective standard to kind of evaluate that, and it's very difficult to know, you know, what is the right rate of conviction, for example. Just there's not an easy answer to that. I mean, but I still think post-legislative scrutiny is a good thing.
Yeah, I mean, just interestingly, in 1994, the Scottish Office estimated that the possibility of hung juries were to be introduced into Scots law in line with English practice. The number would take place annually, would be expected to be in single figures. So it doesn't appear to be something...
Right.
On the basis of that research, anyway, that it's going to be
you've
a huge issue.
You've researched this even more thoroughly than I have.
No, I don't know about
that. Do you want my job?
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much. Okay. Yeah. Thanks.
I think John Swinney wanted to come back in, and Sharon Dewey.
One other issue that I was interested in your view about is in relation to all of the dynamics around about the issues I've been raising with you this morning as to whether in trying to strike the right balance, the appropriate balance, there is a need for us also to consider, given whatever implications there are of those changes, any revisiting of the approach or the threshold for the involvement of the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission in looking at potential miscarriages of justice, if that is a factor that of itself needs to be considered as part of this this pursuit of the right balance to be struck.
I did used to work there, yes. But that was a long time ago.
I'll have to push that one onto you on the basis you've actually worked for them.
No, but I mean, I think that you would have to ask them. But I guess I'm not quite following exactly the thread of the question, in the sense
the point I'm making is let's for argument's sake say that the government's proposal prevails and it's 8 out of 12.
Yes.
You've expressed doubts and reservations to us about that being the appropriate balance. Mm-hmm. And I'm just airing, are there other issues that the committee needs to be mindful of if the government was intent on pursuing that approach, that to maintain that point that we've discussed about the confidence in the criminal justice system?
So I do understand that, but I don't understand what the commission's role would be in that, because, you know, we don't ask juries for a breakdown in terms of the split of a verdict currently. There's obviously a body of law that really prohibits any exploration of their discussion of their evidence. The commission can consider cases whereby they believe there has been a miscarriage of justice and it's in the interests of justice to refer that case back to the appeal court. But, I don't quite draw the connection between how a jury verdict, I mean, there is a ground of appeal in Scots law of unreasonable verdict, but it is very infrequently encountered in the legal system, and it has more to do with the jury behaving somewhat, or patently irrationally in respect of the perhaps charge that they've been given, than it does to do with, well, did they just get this wrong, or what did eight go for it, and the internal dynamics, which we just really don't know anything about because of the Contempt of Court Act and the common law that protects the kind of sanctity of those discussions. So I think I would agree in general that post-legislative scrutiny is a good idea, and that we would need the committee and would need to think very carefully about measures that could be introduced. But we don't really have a ground of appeal in Scots law that, the jury just made a decision that we disagree with.
I mean, if I could just add to that, I can see where you're going with this now, because you're thinking, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you're thinking, well, maybe if there is a slightly increased risk, or not increased, if there is a small risk of wrongful conviction that might result from this, do we have to look at other protective measures that might address that?
That's where exactly you're going with it, isn't it?
And I think that's something we should possibly look at, but I'm not sure the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission is necessarily in the right direction to go with that. I'm not sure they're not really going to do anything to help prevent wrongful conviction in the first instance. I think if we were going to travel down that line of thought, and I don't want to open this up to kind of things that are outside the remit of the bill, but it might be worth looking at actually some of the research on sort of the causes of wrongful conviction and some of the more problematic types of evidence, such as, potential for false confessions, perhaps eyewitness identification evidence and so on, some of the things that we know can actually contribute to wrongful conviction, and perhaps trying to think about, well, do we address those as well as we possibly could? So I can see where you're going with that, but I would probably my train of thought would take it in a slightly different direction to you, okay, towards looking at the sort of things we can do to prevent wrongful convictions kind of happening in the first place.
Okay, thank you.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. You've actually just kind of touched on what I was going to ask there. In the joint submission to the Criminal Law Review, you noted that changing the majority to 2/3 might create an unacceptable risk of wrongful convictions. I was just going to see if you could expand on that a wee bit more.
I mean, only really what we've said already in that, I mean, I suppose in a sense changing it to two-thirds is probably not quite the right way to put it, is it? Because actually prior to this it was what, 8 out of 15? So perhaps not the change that's the important thing here, but actually having 8 out of 12, as I said earlier, to me, does just feel a little bit dangerous in terms of wrongful convictions, because, as I said before, you would have a situation, you know, where actually quite a sizeable proportion of the jury didn't think the person was guilty, but you could still have a conviction.
I've already put on record, I think, that is my tentative position too, but I suspect you speak to other academics, they would disagree with that. You know, I think that we call it a difficult judgment call because that's exactly what it is for politicians. Yeah. And that where politicians eventually land in that respect is hard. And there are arguments on both sides for having 8, for having 10, for having 12.
Public confidence comes into it too, doesn't it? Because, you know, you have to... Most important thing of all is have a criminal justice system that has the confidence of the people of Scotland. And 8 out of 12, is that something that would command public confidence? I'm not sure. I'm not expert on these things, but I suspect if you actually laid it out to somebody that, you know, if we don't just talk specifically about sexual offence cases, but all cases, the idea that you could be, you know, sentenced to life imprisonment on the basis of 8 out of 12... people might be a little bit uncomfortable with that. Having said that, though, we have operated with a system of majority verdicts for many hundreds of years, so maybe not.
Justice. Quickly, I mean, equally on that notion of public confidence, I'm sure that if you spoke to those who represent victims of crime, they will tell you that they would be uncomfortable with 10. So these are difficult decisions that need to be made. Understanding that dynamic and the kind of cultural heritage is key, I think.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I may just ask one final question, and again I'm going to come back to your submission, and it was something that I noticed and I'm quite curious about, and it's staying with the issue around safeguarding against wrongful conviction, in particular in and around sexual offences. So in your submission, if I may just quote, you say that the use of the verdict of not proven is particularly prevalent but particularly problematic in sexual offences cases, where it may enable juries to give weight to myths and stereotypes in avoiding verdicts of conviction. Now, we will be looking at these issues in future sessions.
Yeah.
And while there is no clear evidence that the verdict does in fact safeguard against wrongful conviction, its existence has been used to justify Scots law not introducing other measures which would, meaning that it may in fact be actively harmful in this regard. So I'm just wondering, just looking for a bit more commentary around that.
Right, it's at me, yep. So, well, there's two different things going on there. In relation to the second point, the idea that the not proven verdict has been used to as a justification for not introducing other measures that might help prevent wrongful conviction. There's been a couple of examples of that in the past with various kind of criminal justice reform committees that have been set up. For example, the one that springs to mind was there was a committee, I think it was the Bryden Committee, it was a while ago now. We're talking back in the sort of 1980s, maybe, possibly in the 1970s, but they looked at some of the difficulties of wrongful convictions based around mistaken eyewitness identification, which is one of the kind of known causes of wrongful conviction. And they decided not really to do anything because they decided that actually, well, we've got measures in Scotland already that protect against wrongful conviction, one of which is the not proven verdict. So they didn't actually kind of bring in any particular measures to address the mistaken eyewitness identification problem because we've got all these other features that already kind of address wrongful conviction in a general sense. So that's just one example of that. And then sort of the first point is a slightly different one, which is around just the way that the not proven verdict is used in sexual offence cases. And this is starting to interact a little bit with later parts of the bill, but there was evidence from the jury discussions that some jurors did hold kind of quite false and quite prejudicial beliefs about sexual offences and sexual offence complainers. And this did seem to interact with the not proven verdict in ways that I can't really quantify, but ways where it kind of, it left a space where these things could creep in. It's maybe not the place to say more about that now, because obviously that's a different part of the bill.
Thank you. No, that's really helpful. Okay, I think we will bring our session to a close. Thank you both very much. I think that's been a really helpful and informative session.
Thank you for asking us. Thank you for having us.
So thank you again. And that concludes our public agenda item for today. At our next meeting on the 6th of December, we'll continue with evidence taking on the Victims Bill, and we'll hear from representatives of survivors of crime around the abolition of the not proven verdict and juries' majorities. I can get my teeth back in. So thank you, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.